Sick leg. Welcome to Third Prevent from Caries Symposium. We have a guest from Portugal, Joana Garcez, and she's gonna make a presentation about direct anterior restorations, how to reproduce natural aesthetics with modern composite materials. Direct anterior composite restorations have an important place in restorative dentistry, and we can make natural aesthetic restorations with simple techniques using composite resin. So I think this presentation will be very interesting for you. And now I would like to go on with introducing Joana. She's from Portugal. She has a degree in dental medicine in a university, Portugal, and she has a postgraduate diploma in aesthetic and restorative dentistry. She has a PhD in odontostomatology, and she is the director and lecturer of operative dentistry in the postgraduate program in dentistry. She is a private practitioner with a focus on restorative and aesthetic dentistry, and also she's a board member of European Academy of Digital Dentistry. Nice to meet you again, Joana. Welcome to Turkey. Welcome to our program, our online symposium. And now we can follow your presentation.
Thank you so much. Thank you for this invitation. I'm honored to be here with you today. And now I'm going to share my screen.
Okay.
Okay. So. One second. And here we go. Is it okay?
Yeah, it's okay.
So my presentation here today focuses on anterior direct restorations and how can the clinicians reproduce natural aesthetics with modern composite materials. This is a beautiful picture of a very old ancient library in Porto. It's Livraria Alelo. And here we see the steps. And our work in indirect field is based on the way that how we make all the steps in a very meticulous and predictable way. Through the last three decades, we have been searching for materials and techniques which are capable of providing the closest results to the nature. And we all know that natural enamel and natural dentin are still the best dental materials that we have. So minimally invasive procedures that conserve more the original healthy tooth structure are always preferable in our practice. I think that all of you agree that direct restorations are, in essence, the most conservative procedures in operative dentistry. And today, conservative dentistry is a reality because of the evolution of the adhesive technologies and the dental materials. Adhesive restorations can eliminate the need of more extensive and retentive preparations. And nowadays, we can offer long-lasting restorations to our patients with direct techniques. Like the famous Tolkien trilogy, we dentists also have an obsession that is the reproduction of the natural tooth and the correct replacement of the tooth's lost or absent structures. And this has been one of our biggest challenges over the years. As the materials were introduced to the market with increasingly better systems in terms of optical characteristics, several layering techniques were proposed to follow the evolution of materials, starting in the 80s with the monolaminar technique, passing through Vanini's bilaminar technique, and more recently, a very interesting technique, perhaps more conceptual, has emerged based on the ability of current materials to imitate natural structures. The pentalaminar technique, which was described by Basels and mine in 2014. It is, however, anyway, it is up to the clinician to know and to understand the intrinsic characteristics of each system. Although that's not enough. If the material is important, the operating protocol is paramount. And we have to dedicate attention and be very careful with all the steps involved in the direct technique. Although composite materials present a very mimetic behavior and the chameleon effect on the tooth structure, color assessment is still one of the most challenging steps due to the need to match the shade of the composite resin with a variety of shades and effects of natural tooth. So here is the basic question. How many layers do we need? How many layers do we need to obtain an acceptable and aesthetic result with direct composite restorations? The natural layering concept is a beautiful concept that was introduced in 1995 by Didier Dicci, and it was published for the first time in 1997. And it is based on the idea of approaching nature as closely as possible using a simplified and more reliable approach. Okay, now we are going to cover a few cases in which I will focus on each of the steps involved in the direct technique. This case shows a young patient with both central incisors previously restored with composite resin. We can clearly see the fracture line. There is a certain inflammation of the papilla midline. Also, we also need to correct it. And with this concept, with natural laying concept, we can follow the build. We can perform the build-up technique following the references of natural enamel anatomy, dentin and enamel position and thickness. And this will greatly simplify our clinical application. We can assume that dentin will generate tooth color and enamel will act like a filter which will modulate perception, will produce translucency, and also opalescence. This shade selection process, it must be a systematic procedure. We should do it like a protocol, always in the same way, in order to get predictable results. First, we can use the manufacturer shade guide to do like a first approach to the shade selection, and the selection, and then we will choose the dentin shade and the enamel shade. The dentin shade starts in the cervical part of the teeth, where the enamel thickness is minimal and does not minimally interfere with the evaluation process. And then the selection of enamel is will be made visually in the incisal and proximal areas, and this will be made visually. Then, in some cases, in a few cases, we will add some effect materials to create a lifelike shade in the incisal cord. There are a number of effect materials which are conveniently packaged as flowable materials. And I think this kind of flowable materials, they are easier to apply. And I really like this kind of materials. And we have several shades, like we can see here, and we can, if we do the correct interpretation of the shades in, which are present in the incisal edge, we can mimic with in a precise way the incisal edge. Sometimes we can also do composite check using the composite resin buttons. This can be very useful sometimes. And we should always take photos from our cases. Photos will help us to understand, to interpret the shade, because there is not a formula for all cases. We must customize our shade or our layering to each case. And for that, we need to observe and really understand what can we see in the tooth. So photos are really important. And with three photos, we can also really understand all the features, the optical features that are present in the tooth. This is a small video. Okay, and with three photos and using simple editing tools, we can better understand color. Here we have a reflected light photo. This one is useful to identify the transitional line angles, and because it shows the reflective and deflective areas of the tooth. Also, black and white picture can also be useful to evaluate the value of, namely, the enamel mass value. And finally, the third one, the cross-polarized photography, it is also useful because we have no glare or reflection. And if we use a polarized filter in our flash device, we can really see the shape and the portion of the tooth and do a more objective assessment of shade and translucency. Okay, so three pictures, three photos, and there you have all you need to carry on with the shade matching, with the shade selection. Due to the case complexity, we decided to fabricate a customized tab using the previously matched shades. And sometimes I do this kind of procedure when I have demanding cases, because it provides a more accurate and realistic representation of the natural tooth color combination. Some characterizations can also be added in this placed in this customized sample, and eventually we can always design the tooth morphology and incorporate it at this stage. I think it's useful, and it's we can get more predictability in our results. Simple restorations, like small class for restoration, sometimes they require more treatment planned as some more extensive cases. And by creating this customized shape we can minimize the errors, in the shape matching. So let's start with the procedure. We removed all the material from the surface of the tooth. Small and very small bevel, and all the surfaces were bonded with a three-step etch and rinse adhesive system. Sorry. Then we fabricated a palatal silicon index based on the LOXOP, and this was used as a matrix in the fabrication of the restorations. It is important that this palatal this matrix has the palatal interproximal regions well defined, and because this will prevent the excess resin findings in the proximal areas. Then the build-up, we do the build-up technique. This will follow the references of tooth of natural anatomy, dentin and enamel thickness and position. We must be very accurate in the placement of the dentin mass and all the effect shapes, because we are working in a very narrow, small restorative. We don't have thickness, so we must control each layer very carefully. And now let's check the integrated restoration under different types of illumination. Here we have the reflected light, polarized light, and with the twin flash also, without bouncers. And we can see very pleasant results. And you can see the optical behavior of the composite. It looks pretty natural. Now we are going to focus to approach another case, another young patient who experienced a traumatic injury at 10 years old and fractured her central incisor. As you can see, the right incisor has a notorious darker shade than the left one, which was her major concern. This is the smile after the completion of internal bleaching. We achieved a much wider color, much lighter color. And what else can we see here? We can see an asymmetry in the axis inclination of and in the gingival contour of the two lateral incisors. Therefore, we proposed the patient a gingivectomy. We planned a gingivectomy to establish the proper inclination of the zenith points, and this was followed by direct restorations in both teeth, central incisor and lateral incisor. With this in mind, we performed a diagnostic walk-up. We can ask the technician to do this walk-up, although in some patients I'm the person in charge of it. I choose to do so because a walk-up process takes me one step further as I mentally start working on the tooth morphological design with the ultimate goal to imitate the natural shape. We removed a great portion of the old composite with the CARS disc we can eliminate the remaining material and roughen the prismatic outer enamel layer. We can also use this disc to create a bevel with much control and precision, given the fact that compared to a burr, this cutting cutting action is very little. And as you can see now, there is a deep bevel and all the edges are rounded to achieve an optimal integration of the restoration in the margins. Here is the lateral perspective of the palatal shell after curing. And when done correct, this wall has enough strength to sustain all the following steps. From now on, we will follow the build-up technique, as we mentioned before. Here we can see the dentin mamelons, which were modeled with a dentin mass. Effect materials, in this case, we use a very discrete blue effect between the mammals and an opalescent flowable resin as well to reproduce the transparency and the opalescent natural effect. And some little white spots were also added in this stage. After the dentin buildup, we established the proximal walls using curved transparent strips, and finally we finished with a buccal enamel layer using an enamel mask. It is, if possible, we should make this surface very smooth and uniform in order to save time during the finishing procedures. For the lateral, the direct veneer buildup followed exactly the same layering scheme as we used for the central incisor. And now, finally, we are facing the first stage of the finishing procedure, the macromorphology. We can use a pencil, it can be very useful to gain a better perception of the line angles, of the position of the line angles during the finishing. In this stage, we will create the same morphological elements present in the patient's natural teeth, the proximal contours, the buccal and lingual profile, the transition line angles, and finally the position of incisal edges. In the occlusal view, can appreciate the improvement on the buccal profile of the restored teeth. And this was also provided by the walks-up. The walks-up was really important in this case. The next stage is to reproduce the fine surface details. For this, we use a flame shape 40 microns diamond bar at a low speed with an electric and handpiece. Electric handpiece allow us to control the amount of preparation, and it will be the best tool to do this finishing stage. Then we start finally with the polishing stage. In this case, we use the sequence of three rubber points, starting from pre-polishers to finally high gloss polishers. And when properly done, this surface will get a very natural light reflection. Now take a look at the teeth after total rehydration, and we had this pleasant result. Here you have the reflection light, the bounce light. You can see that shape is has an important role in the final result, and we can have now in this case we have the light reflection is quite similar in both natural and restored teeth. Okay, and then this is the final result, and the impact in this in the patient's smile is also only touching two teeth, we can see a very an improvement in her smile. Okay, let's go to another case. Now we have a veneer in a discolored teeth. All of you, we know that this is one of the most challenging situations that we can have in our clinical practice when talking about direct restorations. As you know, these cases are always complex from the clinical point of view, and here we have a tooth with a recurrence after two internal bleaching treatments. So now it was time to stop and think about another solution for this case. The aim was to correct value and the application of resins and opaquing agents to achieve an equilibration of value and opacity. This process involves a sequence of precise steps and a demanding layering technique. And besides that, there is no great predictability of success in color matches. So how can we overcome these difficulties in such cases? We can build our restoration directly on the prepared tooth without any adhesion. First step is to perform a non-retentive preparation, of course, and then without performing the adhesive techniques, we build our veneer as if we were doing a direct restoration. And finally, we will remove this restoration from the tooth once it is not bonded to the tooth. Now we can use this veneer to do a color mock-up to test and to confirm if the select shades are correct, because you cannot see it in the day because we have a lot of dehydration of the neighbor teeth, so it's really difficult to understand if we have an optical integration of the veneer. So we can send our patient with small spots of flowable resin to bond it to the neighbor teeth. Then in the following days, we can really understand if this is a well-matched restoration or not. After 1 week, if we are pleased with the results, we can perform the entire adhesive cementation of the restoration. In this case, we used heated composite technique to bond the composite veneer. And this is the final result. Perhaps I would have made some changes. However, patient was happy and the result was okay. So we concluded the work in this stage. Okay, now we are almost finishing. We are going to talk a little bit about finishing and polishing. And I will bring you this case. I brought you this case, which is one of the biggest challenges that we have, the presence of black triangles around teeth when closing anterior diastemas. However, this difficulty can be effectively managed when we have this kind of situation. This patient with stabilized periodontal disease, this type of cases become very anesthetic. And in fact, this patient was not feeling comfortable when she smiled. She was young, she was only 29 years old, And giving the current aesthetic requirement regarding smile, and considering that this type of cases are becoming more frequent since the periodontal disease affects a large part of our population, in my opinion, composite resins may be considered an excellent restorative option. As you know, when the distance between the alveolar crest and the contact point is greater than 5 millimeters, the probability of losing papilla is high. This situation is typical in periodontal patients who lose the interproximal bone, a consequence of their pathology. And even after stabilizing, as in the cases of in the case of this patient, she had a compromised gingival display. So which are our goals? The main variable to be controlled is, in these cases, is the interdental morphology of the restoration that will play a fundamental role in the final aesthetic results. By using the mini wings concept, it is possible to compensate for the absence of papilla by creating composite extensions on the interproximal surface of the clinical crowns. It is important in the operatory stage that the rubber dam is properly placed in proper invagination to ensure that the tissues are retracted and that there will not be any leakage during the restorative procedure. Rubber dam must be carefully invaginated around each tooth. All teeth to be restored should be thoroughly cleaned with airflow polishing. And my tip in this kind of situations is to start restoring our teeth on the palatal side. So we must create a more convex emergence profile. In this case, this step was performed freehand, but we also can do it with a silicon index. And you can see now the new emergence profile in the palatal side. And this way, we have support for the transparent matrix during the buccal insertion of the resin. You see that the matrix will not collapse over the tooth, and we have the needed space to do the correction of the emergence profile. We must pay special attention to the finishing and polishing steps. In these cases, we cannot have any plaque retention in these areas. This is the immediate result. As you know, the main etiological factor of periodontal disease is the absence, is the presence of microbial plaques. So our interproximal restorations must be perfectly adapted to the dental surface, and we cannot have any area of plaque retention. Have a look at the X-ray images. And this is how it looks, the baseline. This is a 1 week recall. Look out how the changed the appearance of teeth. And this is after 1 year. After 2 years, it is even better than in the first year. 2 year follow-up, and we are counting now with 3 years, and the restorations look really nice. So this is the armamentarium that we choose for anterior direct restorations: interproximal strips, the medium coarse discs, fine grit, fine diamond burrs, and always the surgical 12 blade, which is very useful. Resuming, we have the first, the macromorphology with the primary anatomy, the proximal contours, transition lines, the buccal and lingual profile, and the incisal edges. And then the micromorphology, where we perform the secondary anatomy and the tertiary anatomy. That we can do with the same burr. And now a small video for you to see.
Laying on the way, staring at the wall, open up my window, head for South Door. No one looks around, no shimmer takes my eye. I lift my head, run by the sky. Feel my way in front, following the sound.
And about the polishing procedures.
Did a full 180, crazy. Thinking about the way I was. Did the heartbreak change me? Maybe, but look at where I ended up. I'm all good already, so moved on, it's scary. I'm not where you left me at all. So, if you don't wanna see me dancing with somebody, if you won't believe that anything can stop me, don't show up, don't come out, don't start caring about me now. Walk away, you know how.
Okay, let's go through another case. This patient is a dentist, and he presented wanting an aesthetic improvement. He was aware of the localized wear of his maxillary teeth, anterior teeth. We could discuss about other options for this patient. However, he was determined about the decision to rehabilitate his teeth with the composite resins, intending something like a long-term mock-up and a no-prep, and also a no-prep approach. Let's analyze and understand in detail this smile. We did a small digital smile design based on facial analysis. The patient desire and was to have a triangular shaped tooth teeth. So and we also needed to correct the level of the gingival level in the left central incisor. We used the digital measurements as a guide to perform the walks up, and then we did all the steps, layering steps, as we've seen before. But now we are doing the six front teeth, and there we go. Teeth were cleaned, all the restorative material were removed. We created very small bevels and rounded all the edges, only to soften the transition between tooth and the restorations. This is the palatal index, as you've seen before. And first, we created the cervical convexity of the left incisor. With this correction of emergence profile, we are able to hold the rubber dam in position without the need of floss ligatures. And then we go through all the layering steps, dentin masses here in the form shells, restore the inner chroma of the tooth and define the mamelon structure. We also added some effect materials between mamelons and to create this natural appearance of the incisal edge. Now the proximal walls, like you've seen before, using curved matrices. And finally, the buccal enamel. At the end of this appointment, the restorations are not completely finished and polished. And besides, we are extremely tired and the patient is also really tired. So all we have to do is stop working. We leave it like this. And all we need to do is to seal the margins and the surface of the composite resin. We can use a surface sealant, and we will cover the surface, protecting it and making it shinier, so that we can carry out the final finishing texture and polishing in a separate appointment 1 or 2 weeks after, okay? So we stop, we have some rest, relax, and send patient home. But first, don't forget, you should take a photo, because you can take this photo before the next appointment, and you can check all the changes that you are going to do in the polishing appointment. And this is the result after all the alterations, all the needed alterations were made. We can refine our restorations and give a lifelike appearance to the restorations in another appointment. In the lateral view, we can check the soft tissue architecture created by the new emergence profile in the restoration. This is can see the incisal effects pretty well here. And as you can see, with a minimally invasive adhesive direct approach, we can improve the smile of the patient with just adding composite material to adhesively treated tooth surfaces without any need of preparation. With composite resin, we can provide a real aesthetic and functional solution. Literature indicates that this kind of direct procedure have high rates of aesthetic results, and only about 11% of cases have shown minor problems in a five-year period, such as a loss of form or wear. Now, we are going to talk about maintenance. Maintenance is mandatory. We know that we must be conscious that most of the limitations of direct restorations are clinical and are dependent on operators, and we have to manage these cases in a long-term period. So, like this patient, she presented wanting an aesthetic improvement. We performed first a freehand mock-up just for the patient to see, have a preview of the final work. And then we we did this case with the direct restorations. I'm not going to talk. The technique is always the same, all the steps like I mentioned before. And this is the results after finishing the cases. And now we are going to see what happened to this case over time. And what can we see after a few years that these restorations have lost few texture and form? And what can we do? We can do repolishing very easily in a maintenance consultation. We can use a felt disc or a rubber point, and we can get luster again. I'm sorry, I'm going to jump because I have this case repeated here. I don't know why.
Okay.
So sorry.
Okay.
And now I'm going to show you a diastema case. We are almost finishing. This is a diastema case. The case when we have diastemas, it's sometimes it's important to have a wax up to establish the correct shapes of teeth. When we have a diastema, small diastema, up to 1 millimeter. We can correct this kind of situations by using only enamel shade, a composite enamel shade. Otherwise, when we have a bigger diastema, we should use two distinct opacities, a dentin mask and an enamel mask to do this correction, this color correction. About tooth preparation, we should be very careful with these cases. All the surfaces, namely the proximal surfaces, must be cleaned. They must be free of plaque. We can use the air cleaning. We can use glycine or sodium bicarbonate. What about the enamel? Is the etching acid etching technique enough to produce the pattern, the ideal pattern for adhesion? We should always remove the aprismatic outer layer. And for this, because this layer is resistant to the acid etching, so for that we can use a rough disc, a coarse disc, to roughen the surface. We can also use a fine diamond strip can be very useful because we can go to the narrower areas where the access is more difficult. And then we start with bonding procedures and the step-by-step layering, as you've seen before. I prefer to do one tooth first and then go to the other one to control the emergence profile and the position of the middle line between teeth. Be very careful with the bonding procedure, especially in the more cervical area of the tooth. Then confirm the correction based on your workup. And then do go to the other. After building a lingual shell, the emergence profile is created, and you I prefer using pre-contoured matrices. These matrices will be placed in the sulks and will be stabilized with and marginal sealed by the rubber dam. This is one type of matrices that I appreciate. We can get a very smooth occlusal gingival anatomy, avoiding flat embrasures. And pay attention to the position of the strip. It forms a 45 degree angle with the long axis of the tooth. And with the pull-through technique, we can have a nice adaptation and contour of the material in the proximal area. Okay, here it is, the second tooth, and now the final outcome. Okay, to conclude and to close the circle, let's go back to our bigger challenge, our obsession. When we see cases like this one with beautiful and complex natural teeth from an optical point of view, for example, like this case, we ask ourselves if we would be able to reproduce such a case in a predictable way. But in fact, these cases come to our clinic, and this one came to my office. She is a girl. She's a girl, a dentist, and we had very beautiful dentition, and a big responsibility to reproduce this case. A complex dentin structure, as you can see here in cross polarized photography, a lot of translucency and opalescence in the incisal third, and well, composite have evolved over the last years. The particle sizes, the polishability, the longevity of restorations, bonding was also improved. But again, what hasn't changed much was our shape taking technique. Perhaps the fear about using technology and protocols which will allow us to obtain through photographic records numerical values for the description of color, making shade selection a more objective stage in contrast to what happens in the traditional visual method, which is subjective and influenced by operator's perception. So in this case, we used this photo analysis to help us to choose the resins. This is what I wanted to share with you. Thank you again. Thank you so much. It was a pleasure to be here today. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you for this very nice and informative presentation, Joana. And you gave us very good tips and tricks about the procedures in anterior direct anterior composite restorations. And now you're welcome. And now we're going to get some questions from the participants, from our participants. I'm going to check the comments, but now I couldn't see any question about the presentation. Okay, and I have some questions, especially the questions about new composite materials. I mean, what do you think about universal shades in anterior direct restorations? There are some brands in the dental market, such as Omnichroma from Tokiyama, and also Universal Composite, Universal Shade Composite from GC. Now, Kuzer and Kurorai also have put new materials on the market. All manufacturers claim that they use different technology to reflect the surrounding shades of the tissue. And what's your experience with these universal shades? Can they be successful in anterior, direct anterior restorations?
I don't have much experience with these type of materials, as I am a big fan of layering different opacity materials. But I think this kind of materials can be useful in very particular cases, like some diastema cases, veneering cases. If we have a very demanding case, like an incisal third, where we can develop a natural-like appearance, I think we cannot use this kind of approach. But yes, it has a place. It has a place in our clinical practice because it facilitates our protocol, and we can achieve very pleasant results in some kind of situations.
Yes,
but not for all cases.
Especially for fractured cases, we can encounter some problems during clinical procedures. And also, in one of your cases, you use intracoronal bleaching technique. For bleaching the discolored teeth, and yes, it's a very good technique. But in some situation, we can encounter with relapse in the color, in the shade, by time. And if there's a relapse in the patients, what do you do in such kind of patients? Do you reapply the bleaching process
when we have the relapse?
Yeah.
In cases when we have a relapse,
in bleaching, relapse in bleaching, in intracoronal bleaching.
Yes, if patient comes from other dentist, and the patient mentions that he had underwent bleaching in other dentist, I usually repeat the internal bleaching if it was not me who did the first time. But of course, sometimes my cases always also relapse. And if it was me who did it for the first time, I never repeat it. In those cases, all we have to do is do a deeper preparation and work in the substrate with opaque masses and try to veneer it. But I like the internal bleach, even knowing that in about 35% of the cases have a relapse, but I still do it because the color will never relapse to the first, to the original dark shade. So in that way, I can minimize the degree of preparation.
Yes, it's the most minimal invasive technique, bleaching. I agree with you. But in some cases also I encounter with relapse because relapse in intracoronal bleaching can be seen in nearly 30% of the patients. So, okay, I think you prefer masking the discolored portion in your cases also. Mm. And yes, there's no question. Yes, okay, now we can close the session. Thank you very much for participating in this organization. You made really very good, very nice presentation and informative presentation for our patients, for our participants. So now we can close the discussion part and also we can finish the program. Thank you very much, Joanne. Nice to meet you.
Thank you so much. Thank you again. Nice to meet you. Nice to meet you. Bye-bye.